Hi and welcome to this Automic Automation demo video, featuring the process monitoring perspective. If you have upgraded from a version earlier than 12.0, you'll notice that most of the functions of the former activities and periods views are now in the process monitoring perspective. The user interface is organized in perspectives that reflect user roles. The process monitoring perspective is the main working area of operators and managers. It displays comprehensive data on active and inactive tasks. In the process monitoring perspective, you keep an eye on processes, make sure that the workload gets processed every day without incidents. Identify problems, perform basic root cause analysis, and react to failures. This perspective also offers a search functionality for the past executions of your tasks. Namely, you can search for already deactivated tasks using the task filter function. This gives you quick access to the history of all your executions. Let's have a look at it. The left pane has three tabs with links to the content of the perspective. The Forecasts tab has links to three views: forecasts, auto forecasts, and the agent slots. There are object and task forecasts. Both predict expected execution times and the estimated runtime of the objects or tasks. Object forecasts help you optimize processes, resources, and maintenance periods. Task forecasts let you know when tasks will start and how long they will need to complete. The Auto Forecast tab provides a preview of future executions on a particular date, at a specific time, or within a period of time. With the Auto Forecast function, I can plan maintenance activities, notify users in time, or optimize the start time of critical tasks. It simulates running the tasks in your system. The Auto Forecast uses estimated runtimes, which are calculated from the period defined by the administrator in the system configuration. If, for example, I have to carry out an agent upgrade, I must identify maintenance windows in my system. I need to know when there is a time frame in which the agents are idle. On the agent slots page, I can let the system calculate those slots. Once calculated, I can easily filter them using the filter pane on the right. The Services tab is the control center of your SLO objects, that is, service level objective objects. They are the basis of the service level management feature. The fulfillments list lets you know if the services meet the criteria defined in their service level agreement. The list indicates whether the criteria are met or not. The Tasks tab is your main working area. It shows the list of active and inactive tasks and provides comprehensive data about their execution. Let's have a closer look at its components. The Quick Filter provides a fast way to restrict the number of tasks in the list. By default, it filters by queue. I'll expand the drop-down list. Queue, agent, and status are predefined filter criteria. The others are customized values that your administrator can define as custom attributes. The Quick Filter is a shortcut to some of the filter criteria available in the filter pane. For example, if you select queue and one of the queues in the drop-down list, the list of tasks shows the tasks processed by that queue. If you use the queue filter criterion in the filter pane on the right, and then select the same queue, you get the same result. Let's have a look at the toolbars now. This is the task bar. It shows the number of tasks in the list. This number depends on the list mode that I have chosen. Now I am in hierarchical mode, which means that the list is displayed as a tree view, where only parent tasks are displayed. I have to expand them to see their children. I'll select the flat list mode. The list displays all tasks without showing which ones are parent and which ones are children. The number refers to all the tasks that are available in the list, parents and children alike. I'll go back to the hierarchical mode. Choosing the appropriate list view is also important when you use the filter function. If the flat list mode is selected, the filter settings apply to all tasks. If the hierarchical mode is selected, the filter applies to the parent tasks only. Let's move to the next button. There are various ways to guarantee that the list of tasks is up to date. One of them is pressing the refresh button in the taskbar. You can also define automatic refresh intervals in your user settings. The status bar is immediately below the taskbar. It indicates how many tasks are on each of the available main statuses. These numbers refer only to the tasks that are currently visible. If the list is filtered, the number of tasks in each status refers to the filtered list, and not to all tasks available in the system. This is the toolbar. Its buttons are shortcuts to the most important task functions. I'll select a task. This enables the buttons that are available for the task, according to its type and status. This is one way of accessing the task functions. Another way is right-clicking the task to open the context menu. I can also select many tasks and right-click. In this case, the context menu shows only the functions that are available and common to all those tasks, according to their types and statuses. The toolbar contains some more buttons. I have already explained the export table function in the process assembly video, so I'll move forward to the filter and details buttons. The filter button hides and shows the filter pane, where I can restrict the number of tasks in the list. The quick filter, that I showed you previously, is a fast way to access some of the filter possibilities that I have here. Task name, task type, and status are the most common filter criteria, and they are always visible. I cannot hide them. To use other parameters, I click the Add Filter Criteria button. Then, I select a filter criterion. The corresponding field is added to the pane. To remove it, I click the trash icon. Instead of defining filters that I usually need once and again, I can save them as custom filters. In big installations, the list of tasks can contain thousands of records. To avoid performance issues, you can configure objects so that they are deactivated automatically after processing has finished. By default, deactivated tasks are not displayed in the list. To display them, I activate the Include Deactivated Tasks checkbox at the bottom of the pane. Again, to avoid performance issues, only the tasks that have been deactivated within the past 12 hours are shown. As you see, the time frame filter criterion is automatically set to 12. The list of tasks shows the columns with the most important task information. However, there are more columns available. For example, my list does not show information about the estimated end time of my tasks. To show it, I click the arrow at the end of the header row. The drop-down list displays all available columns. The ones that are visible have a tick. I'll select estimated end time. This adds the column. Although the list already provides important information about each task, there are many more details that I might need. To see those details, I select the task and click the Details button. I'll drag the left border of the Details pane to be able to read the data more comfortably. As you see, this pane provides much information. For example, it lists the object variables applied to the task and the values that those variables used during execution. It also provides a summary of the notifications associated with the task, and so forth. Many task types have their own monitor view. Combined with the lists of executions and with the reports, the monitors provide all the information you need to understand how tasks behave. I'll show you two examples. First, a workflow monitor. I'll right-click a workflow and select Open Monitor. As you see, it has many similarities with the workflow editor. Let's go back to the list of tasks so that I can show you a schedule monitor. I right-click it and select Open Monitor. Here it is. That was a short overview of the process monitoring perspective. You can find more information in our documentation at docs.automic.com.